Before we start this episode of Krypton Report, I want to take a moment and just give a shout out here to our Patreon. I know what you're thinking. Gosh, everyone's asking for money, and I get it. But our Patreon is only $1. $1 a month that helps us keep the podcast going. And what we do is we try to find interesting shows and topics and whatever we want to talk about. We've done, as of this little thing, our last recordings were on the Scream series. Brian and Tyler, that's me, do our own show where we record in the car, and it's kind of funny. And we talk about pop culture or whatever is going on. We also have the Supernatural podcast we've been reworking. It's taken some time just because of life. But we do movie commentaries as well. It's something that James and I have done, what used to do on the main show that we've started doing here. So for $1 a month on our Patreon, you can get those shows. There's at least 4 a month. Also, there's my movie pitch show that I do. But also, what we want is if you're a Patreon, you can come on. You can come on the main show if you want. Or if there's something you want to come on and talk about, we can do it as a Patreon special. So all I want is for $1 a month, think about chipping in, joining our Patreon, and you have a voice to be a part of things. Follow the link in the link tree or in the show notes below, patreon.com/KryptonReport.
Part of the Press Play Podcast Network.
Look up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's...
This is Jason J. Lewis, the voice of Superman on Justice League Action.
This is Mark Wade, writer of Superman Birdlight.
You're listening to The Krypton Report.
Alright, welcome to Flash Week. This episode was originally supposed to be a Patreon exclusive special, but we decided what the heck, we'd drop it in. So, welcome for joining us. It is I, Tyler, and with me is my beautiful one. Not James, but Jania.
Hi. The other beautiful one will probably be on the next episode. We'll see.
Maybe. So, we decided to, since it's kind of funny, we thought, I want to do this one with Jania, partially because she's such a Mark Hamill fan. Yeah. Back in the 90s, for those people who don't know, there were places that you would go and you'd rent videotapes. There was Blockbuster.
One you're very familiar with.
And there were other mom and pop style, like Kroger's had their own video store. You know, like, what? Well, that's where my grandma rented videos with Kroger.
Wow.
And we were in a lot of videos at Farm Fresh there in Virginia. But they released, like we talked about before, the pilot was released in a VHS, kind of so you could rent it. It was like a made-for-TV movie. But then they released what was titled Flash 2, Revenge of the Trickster. They took the two episodes that featured Mark Hamill, the Trickster, and then Trial of the Trickster, and then basically edit them, put them together, and build it as like a second TV movie and sold it where you could rent it at your local video store. So we thought we'd just kind of talk about that as a bonus episode, which is kind of just fun. So Mark Hamill, who is, you know, known for that one small movie you've maybe heard of it called Star Wars. You heard of that?
Mm.
You ever heard of that, Jania?
I think I've heard something about it.
Something about Force,
yeah.
Lightsabers, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. You're not my father.
Yeah, yeah.
But you are my father.
Yeah, something about dads. Now, what's fun is this episode was in 1991. Well, they both were. But in the episode, we meet...
Guess what? I was born that year.
Yeah.
In the episode, we meet...
We meet James Jesse, and he's psychotic, and he's going after Megan Lockwood, who is this private eye, tough girl type that Barry is...
Not a damsel in distress, as she says.
Yeah, attracted to, and it's slowly, like, James goes from being, like, this actor, deceptive, creepy guy to being, you know, like, a costumed... villain. One of the interesting things was the Trickster episode was like the first episode, if I remember correctly, that delved with being a supervillain. Like they stayed away from it in the show, but then the Trickster was like their biggest one, especially also because it was Mark Hamill, who then later would go on to voice the Trickster in the animated DC film or Justice League cartoon. So he just kind of, you know, there's an episode of Justice League Action that's hilarious because it's Mark Hamill driving a cab that the Joker gets in and the Trickster. So it's Mark talking to Mark.
I love it.
And his, like you just said, his Trickster is so interesting because...
To say the least.
It's, I mean, his Trickster is great. And, you know, he would revive... What's so funny is, like, these episodes are almost like prequels in a way to the episodes that would come later in the Flash 2014 series. Because you have Mark Hamill being Jesse James again.
Mm-hmm.
Or James Jesse, my bad.
Yeah.
It's late.
It's flip-flopped.
They reference him terrorizing Central City. Mm-hmm. They go to his hideout, which is the same hideout that we saw in this. And then later, the actress who played Prank comes back, and we find that the current Trickster is their child.
Wow.
So they both come back. And even Billows is the mayor, who's the cop in this.
That's funny.
So, like, it's this very wink, nod, kind of thing going on.
But that's then, a little bit more than a wink and a nod.
But then you have the great episode of Mark Hamill cameos in. It's in season 3, where he's the Trickster of Earth 3 fighting Jay Garrick, John Wesley Shipp. He's got purple hair, and he's very much more menacing and Joker-esque.
Yeah, I remember that one.
So, but what's so interesting, and you brought it up, because, Jania, give everyone, what's your, like, little history that you've had with the John Wesley Shipp version of The Flash?
Not a lot. Not a lot at all. You and I have watched, like, one other episode prior to this episode. I remember, actually, it was, like, a couple of years back, you were like, hey, watch this. And we kind of laughed about it together and stuff. I heard about it before, like, my parents kind of talked about it on and off here and there, but, like I said, I was born in 1991, so it really wasn't anything that was very prominent for me, but the way that I heard about it the most was through, like, family members and stuff, so, but I heard about it. I didn't really watch it until I sat with you.
Well, I mean,
I don't even remember what episode we watched. I just remember the beginning of it, and us talking about it, and, like, we talked about the score and stuff like that.
Yeah, it was probably like 8 years ago.
It's been a while.
Because I bought this season. I found it one day. It was shortly after Solomon was born. Okay. I was at Walmart and they had the whole DVD collection for $10. And I bought it as one of those things that I would watch at night when I was up with him.
Yeah, 8 years ago, a couple years ago.
It's all relevant.
It's 2020, everything's
just, I mean, because I had never seen the whole series.
Right.
You know, because they moved it around and it was young. And I saw the pilot and I saw one of the Trickster. I think the first one. It's hard to say because I just remember Mark Hamill.
Mark Hamill.
But what's interesting about this film, so to speak, is its nature of... So you brought up the music.
Mm-hmm.
So the film, the TV series The Flash came in 90. The year after Tim Burton's Batman.
Okay.
And it was kind of like, oh, that was hot. So what could we do on TV? And they decided to produce a Flash TV series very much similar to Tim Burton's Batman.
Right.
Okay.
And the music.
Danny Elfman came on, wrote the score, the theme for The Flash. But then this lady named Shirley Walker wrote all the other music.
For this.
But do you know what Shirley Walker would go to do?
What?
Batman the Animated Series.
Yup, that makes a lot of sense. Because when I told Tyler, as I'm sitting here and I'm listening to the score and whatnot, I hear Batman the Animated Series more than anything else. Like, I literally, as we were sitting here watching it, I added the da-da-da-da-da, whatever that part right there is, you can hear it in your head.
So you can definitely hear where... Shirley Walker would come in and reorchestrate things for Batman Animated Series. Then you have Mark Hamill, who, of course, would go on to be the Joker on Batman Animated Series. Because he's Mark freaking Hamill. And his Trickster is very proto-Joker. But there's somebody else in this that I told you to look at and tell me what you thought of, because it really felt like maybe Paul Dini saw this episode and was like, I'm going to create a character.
Oh, yeah, Prank. Prank, for sure. Because the relationship between... Actually, it was almost uncanny in the way that it was brought up in this episode, or they were displayed in this episode. Prank and the Trickster are a lot like the Joker and Harley Quinn in Batman, the animated series.
This is before Harley Quinn was even created.
Yeah.
Like, before she was even created.
So this could have been an inspiration character, and I'm going to guess that it is for Harley Quinn's creation.
But what's interesting is I caught Mason says that he put her in a very Harley Quinn jester outfit or Harley Quinn something outfit when he tries to make her prank in the first episode before we actually get the real prank in the second one.
Yeah.
And if you look at when Mason comes into the courtroom, her color scheme and patterns are pre-Harley. It was a red, orangish-looking jacket, a white shirt with black, and then there was diamonds.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Yeah. Pretty interesting. Paul, if you did copy, it's cool, bro.
We all need something that inspires us, you know? We all need, as creators, like, there's something that, like, you bounce off of. You're like, oh, hey, that's a cool idea, and then you just create your own version of something. You know, that's just creation in general.
But it yes, you're right. And I say it's interesting because Mark Hamill was not the first actor cast to voice the Joker. It was Tim Curry.
I believe that.
And he went in and did some lines, and there's recording out there that's never been released. It's probably
that'd be so cool.
Of his voice. And all I've ever been able to discover was that it was similar to his Pennywise voice.
So it would probably have been too creepy in that aspect. Or... And I mean this with the utmost respect because I really look at Tim Curry as somebody who is extremely talented and I respect as a major talent. But I could see it being something that was even a little too cheesy, you know? Not... Because Mark Hamill...
There's a playful menace to it.
Well, the reason why he's so entertaining as the Joker... is because he goes from these highs and then he goes down into these lows. And the lows, when he goes to the lows, you're like freaking terrified. Because you know that he's like about to do something heinous. Mm-hmm. You know? But then he makes everything playful and fun again. And you just, his voice and his demeanor, even here with the Trickster, we see like he is the perfect candidate for that. Because he can play the spectrum.
Yes.
Easily. And he can play it from, like, if we're talking in the you know, theme of music here, it'd be like jumping from, you know, one octave to, like, three octaves down. Like, the dude is just, like, all over the freaking scale. You know?
Oh, I totally... I mean, it's impressive. Like I told you, it's amazing how he's been, you know, the definitive Joker for so long. What else I find, this interesting that I didn't realize, so I was digging some doing some research, is, so this show is influenced by Batman 89. These two episodes, makeshift 1991 movie, influences another director when this director decides to make a film called Batman Forever and Batman and Robin. So Joel Schumacher was heavily influenced by the Flash Trickster episodes.
That makes a lot of sense, especially when you look at Batman and Robin.
I read that, and then I'm watching this with you, and I'm like, oh, dear Lord. Like, even some of the stuff, just thinking about how over the top Tommy Lee Jones is as Two-Face, and I'm like, oh, wow. Should've just got Mark Hamill to do it.
That's a whole other episode that we could go into, but, like, not that I don't appreciate Tommy Lee Jones, but... it just feels like his character shouldn't have been that out there. Felt like he was so out there. He almost felt like he was trying to be a Joker.
Because that's the problem. Is everyone saw the Joker and just sat in Jack Nicholson and decided, oh, that's how you do these type of characters. They didn't really study their character. But
yeah, exactly.
Anyways.
Jack Nicholson?
Yeah. Solomon and I just watched Batman 89 today.
I thought you were meaning Tommy Lee Jones. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Tommy Lee Jones looked at Jack Nicholson and was like, oh, that's how you act a comic book character. And just went, okay, we just go over the top and crazy. But, you know, I enjoy this show for what it is. Mm. I do have a fun spot in my, you know, vague childhood collective because I saw a few episodes and it was neat. And, you know, watching this with you now, it's like so many 90s-isms. I think some of the fun is just as Flash fans seeing, you know, how many people. Okay, in this one episode, we have Julio, Barry, Tina, the Trickster, Prank, and the police officer. That's six actors in this episode who then reappear in the 2014 Flash series. All playing almost the same character.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So one of the things that I noticed in this episode is somebody who doesn't, who's not familiar with, you know, the series and whatnot, or even the Flash comics of the time, was it common or was it accurate to Barry's character for him to be somebody who is kind of a, we'll call him a player?
Player. Well, the problem is, and this is something Brian and I talked about, was at the time, Barry Allen's dead. It's all Wally West. It's all early Wally West in the comic. I mean, his suit on here is almost a Wally. It is more Wally West style. The only difference is Barry's lightning bolt has the two zigs in it, whereas Wally just has a one zig in it. And then Wally always had small white eye holes, and this Barry's are a little bit wider.
Okay.
And other than that, you're pretty much looking at a Wally West costume. So you have Barry, and then you have Wally, and John Wesley's kind of an amalgam of the two characters.
So it's more accurate to Wally, is what you're saying, as far as
Wally was much more of a fun, loving, confident person. Barry was always more, I from what, you know, I've read, and I haven't read everything, more kind of hindered. And, you know, Iris is in the pilot of this, and she's nothing like her comic counterpart. And then after the pilot episode, they wrote her out and tried to do the will they, won't they thing with him and Tina.
I felt like, to be honest with you, like, if there was anything that bothered me in the show was, like, just from what I know of Barry Allen and The Flash, like, that conceptualization of his part of his character with the female, you know, side characters there, like, it felt forced and it felt inauthentic to the character.
You're like, hey, you're no Dick Grayson, dude.
Right? You're supposed to be like, I would expect this from Bruce Wayne. I wouldn't expect this from, you know, Barry Allen. Like, to me, he's a little bit more
nerdy, squeaky, clean guy.
Yeah, wholesome.
Barry's a science nerd.
I don't know.
Yeah, wholesome is a good way of, it's a very good way of summing him up. Like, so it is like, you know, it's kind of supposed to be a little 90s, a little edgy, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I could feel them kind of pushing the romance, too. And I think that irritated me slightly because it was like, for me, that's like not why I'm there. But in order to sell something like that in the 90s, I would assume that you would have to push the romance angle more. So I'm not going to knock it, but at the same time, it's just kind of like, man, that just didn't feel authentic. It didn't feel real or right.
I have not looked. But just watching this, knowing that it was filmed in a back lot and everything, some of the shots remind me of the back lot set from Lois and Clark. And I'm kind of curious. But speaking of Lois and Clark, did you see who else appeared in this episode at the policeman's costume ball?
Oh, yes.
Did not catch
it.
The
man in blue himself, Mr. Superman.
Superman is referenced. One of the police officers is dressed as Superman. That's hilarious. So Superman exists in this continuity on this Earth somewhere. The Earth 90. We know this is Earth 90, Jania.
Mm-hmm.
So we know that at least one other superhero exists because somebody is dressed like him. So that was funny. I didn't catch that before.
That was pretty funny.
Now let's see.
I have to say that the cop's costume of him coming in as the Flash was freaking hilarious. It was like Zorro meets the Flash. It was so funny to me.
Oh, yeah. And then she's like, you're like number 11. And he looks around. There's like
a bunch of people
dressed as the Flash.
Yeah, different versions of it.
I did like... Okay, so what I found interesting too is they do the... Jesse leaves a James... James Jesse for a dyslexic person sucks. Leaves a bomb, and it has a statue of Mercury, which is a callback to the style of Jay Garrick, but it's exactly how Alex Ross would later draw the Flash, who is Jay Garrick in Kingdom Come.
Yep.
Where he's just like energy.
Yep.
So I thought that was just very interesting. It makes me kind of want to ask, Alex Ross, were you inspired by this? Because, you know, it is, typical with being inspired by the TV series to the comics and the comics, to the shows. And
especially when you didn't have that much content back then.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, when there wasn't very many examples of that kind of thing, you would look at something like this and you would be like, that's everything, and you base your ideas off of
it. What stinks is this show could have been a big hit had they kept not changing the night that it was on. Because it had trouble in the ratings because it kept changing when it was aired. And you got great guest stars like Mark Hamill. And the thing is, a lot of times these comic book shows did well when there was only like one or two on because every fan of the comic book or whatever would watch them just because we had something.
Mm.
And recently, and I say recently because so many have been canceled and all that, there was a plethora of comic book shows on TV, And it was like, you could pick and choose. And there still are a good bit, but there's, as far as DC shows, it's only like down to three. With a few, like you have Sandman, which is technically DC, but not really like what you think of when you think of DC. Anyways... The Trial, Revenge, / The Trickster is it's fun. Like, Mark Hamill is great.
End, when he's in his cell, and they're, like, panning back from his cell, like, he's so the Joker right there. I told Tyler, I was like, he would have made a fantastic live-action Joker hadn't he had the opportunity at that time.
Yes. And, I mean, it's weird because, I mean... You did have, everyone's like Jack Nicholson for Joker in 89. And I need to finish reading that book, that other Michael Uslan book that I have. I need to do that as soon as I finish Voices from Krypton. Because Mark Hamill wasn't like an unknown dude. He was Luke Skywalker. And you're just coming off Return of the Jedi.
Right.
It's not like it's like, hey, who's that guy? He was in something, wasn't he? Where he had like a light thing, but no, I highly recommend what stinks is the CW Seed used to be a streaming thing, and then they put a lot of stuff that was on CW Seed. It was like all these shows that the CW picked up that were theirs or not theirs, and they would stream it, and it doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. Like some of the shows went to on the CW app, but the CW Seed had some interesting stuff, and for the longest time, The Flash was on there. And so, and I'll say this, and I've said this many times, I miss DC Universe.
Mm-hmm.
And before anyone gets up on my grill, Max, since now that HBO Max is Max, they've sold off some of their stuff. You're starting to see DC stuff pop back up on Netflix again. But DC Universe was everything. They put everything there. You know, The Adventures of Superman, Superboy, The Flash, Wonder Woman 77, the old Shazam stuff. The stuff that people like me who appreciate these characters would like to go back and just visit, you know?
Absolutely.
And now that it's not there, there's nowhere to watch The Flash. If you don't own it, you're not streaming anywhere.
Yeah.
And it's getting harder to find because it... to buy, and so I'm lucky I got our copy for $10. But any other final thoughts, Ju? My love, my sweet thing.
I think it's fun. I think it was a fun episode to watch. You can get through some of the romance parts for myself. And it's crazy, too, because I actually don't mind romance in these kinds of shows, but it was just... It was like, it felt just a little bit overly saturated with it, so...
I mean, honestly, if I were to really go back and, like, edit this... down more, I would go back in, remove most of the romance of Mason in the Lockhart. Did I keep saying Mason?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm tired. It's late. I was talking Lois and Clark earlier. Mason was a maid for Lois and Clark attorney that was a love interest for Clark that ends up getting murdered.
We're talking about Megan.
Yeah. So I was too many M's for characters that were created for TV shows, not comic book characters at this late hour. But we have to record when we can because the kids are asleep.
Yay.
I would cut out a lot of her early stuff. I would retweak some things and make it tighter and more Mark Hamill focused.
Yeah.
Because he's really, when he's on screen, it's interesting.
Yeah, he sells it.
John Wesley Shipp's doing his thing, doing a good job, but Hamill looks like he's having a blast. He knows the assignment. He's bringing the character to life.
Yes, absolutely.
Look up in the sky.
We just want to say, if you've enjoyed this podcast, please check out other podcasts on the Press Play Podcast Network. We're going to press pause and hear a few words from our other podcasts on Press Play Podcast Network.
Hello, Brooks here with the Books with Brooks monthly book club podcast. Here's how Books with Brooks works. We read one book a month, and then we talk about it. Classics like Stephen King's The Shining, debut novels like We Are the Brennans by Tracy Lang, and tons of other compelling, life-changing stories, one book and one month at a time. So come read along with us, and then listen in.
If you are like Tyler and James and can't get enough Super Talk, check out these other podcasts. Digging for Kryptonite, Supergirl Radio, The Last Sons of Krypton, The Superboy Legacy Podcast, All-Star Superfans, Superman the Animated Podcast, The Aspiring Kryptonians, Always Hold On to Smallville, The Geek of Steel, and Truth, Justice, and Hope.
Remember to check out Krypton Report on all social media platforms. Go to linktree.com/KryptonReport. You find all of our
reports. This is Dan Jurgens, and if you want to have a good time, keep listening to the Krypton Report.